This here is the Geekom AS6. It's a Windows 11 Pro mini PC powered by the Ryzen 9 6900HX APU. It does have 680M graphics, which is very potent for integrated graphics. DDR5 support, so two RAM slots, PCIe 4 support, two slots of those. It comes this configuration with 32 gigabytes of RAM and 1 terabyte drive. Now it can run 4 displays at 4K 60. We have Thunderbolt 4 support with it, USB 4 support, and also Type A ports as well. And even though it's small, it does have room for a 2.5 inch drive if you wanted to add one and expand upon the storage. So here is our box. There are two versions. So we have the Ryzen 7 version, and I do have here the top spec one. So it's the Ryzen 9, the 6900HX. So we get a power cable, EU1 for me, HDMI cable, and we get some paperwork here. So one of them is just telling you how to install. You'll see here how to install the Visa mounting bracket. We've got a thank you card here, and then our user guide. There's also a bunch of screws here for that Visa mount and our power supply, which is a Delta brand 150 watts. Size wise it is very small and a nice build quality to it. So you can see that it's powered by ASUS. This is basically one of their units here, and it's an ODM but under the Geekom branding here with it. Now we've got two USB 3.2s gen 1s here at the front. This is a USB 4 Type-C, 3.5mm headphone jack, status LED, power on. Either side here, there is plenty of ventilation, but this side does have a little gap there for the Kensington lock slot. The other, there is just absolutely nothing there, but I do like the amount of ventilation we do have. And then look at the back here, even more ports. So the Type-C port at the front, that does support its 40 gigabits per second video out, 8K. And we do have then two HDMI 2.1s, DisplayPort 1.4, another USB Type-C. This is USB 4, so really good to see this. And then three Type-A's here, USB 3.2. This is 2.5 gigabit LAN and our power in, so it's really got us covered for ports. If I was being really picky, I could say the only thing that is missing here would be an SD card slot, but it's easy enough just to plug an adapter. So the back here, this is where all the hot air is going to be blown out. There is a vent here on the bottom, and we have these four screws with rubber feet. Now, removing these four screws here is how you can gain access to the internals, which I will show you shortly. We can add a 2.5 inch hard drive if you wanted to do so. These are the mounting points there for that Visa mounting bracket. And the top of it, this is made out of plastic, and there is this little guide here on how to gain access to those internals. Now the internals here, so it does look very good the way they've got this set out. There is this big ribbon cable here you've got to be careful of. Now you can remove it, unplug it. I don't like to because the connectors are very fragile. I've broken them before in the past. So we have here two PCIe 4.0 slots. So the drive they're using is a Kingston, and the label on it does state it's a MV2 brand one. So that's PCIe 4.0 speeds. I'll give you a sample of that later on in this video. And then we've got two crucial RAM slots right here. Now this is DDR5. It is 4800 megahertz they're using here with those. So you can upgrade the RAM, you can upgrade, add SSDs. Right here is where you can slot in a 2.5 inch drive that plugs in this side. And just under where the SSD is, I've already loosened off that and removed that screw, just so I can show you here, is our Wi-Fi card. So that's Wi-Fi 6E, and it is MediaTek. So really good components they've used inside, good upgradeability here, and very easy to access this. The only thing is this ribbon cable, do have to be a little bit careful with it. Here's our BIOS. Now, I normally wouldn't show this because there's not really anything we can do in here. There's just a few settings under advanced. None of them are useful. So CPU configuration is just giving us information about pretty much what we already know. Graphics configuration, can we dedicate more RAM to the 680M? Nope, no option for that. What about, no, nothing here really. So platform configuration, there's no option there for power limits either. Under monitor, that's just simply you can set the fan control. You could put it into silent, quiet mode if you wanted to. And then our boot order, that's it. So really quite a lockdown BIOS. So as you'd expect with this kind of configuration, it is very quick, day-to-day tasks, general Windows performance, excellent. So it does run Windows 11 Pro. I'll just show you the free amount of RAM we do have here. So a little bit is dedicated, about 800 megabytes to that Radeon, so the 680M. Now the maximum turbo is 4.9 gigahertz. We have 8 cores, 16 threads in total. And the SSD speeds here, that Kingston drive, the MV2, 1 terabyte, a little disappointing. It's only the sequential reads that are faster than the previous generation, the PCIe 3.0. So it could be a lot faster. You could upgrade this, of course. You could put something like a Samsung 990 Pro in there if you wanted to max out those speeds. But good, we do have those two drives in there that offer PCIe 4.0 support. Now, the benchmarks I have run here, I don't really want to go overboard with benchmarks because I do find that a little bit boring, but you can see that it's very potent, that we have a very good multi-core score here. Now, this won't beat the current 13th gen of Intel's, but we don't really have any mini PCs with those chips yet, the 13, say, 900 or the 13, 980H. But it's a very good score still for what it is for AMD, and it does have the better integrated graphics, which I think most people want anyway, because Intel's integrated graphics, they are lagging behind compared to what AMD's now capable of. And this right here is our, sorry, not that window here, the Geekbench 6 score. And this does prove again that very, very powerful really for the size of it. It's only little, but yet it can run 4 displays out at 4K 60, each one of them. So pretty impressive there spec wise. Now video playback, this here is the Jellyfish test file, HEVC 4K. And you'll see that it is pretty much flawless, the playback. There's no drop frames. The 680M is handling this really well, and I would expect nothing less really from this kind of configuration. It does have the faster RAM and plenty of RAM too, the 32 gigabytes. Same goes for the Sony Swordsmith file here, so that is playing really well. No problems, no lag, and most importantly, no dropped frames there. So temperatures, I have been monitoring those, of course. HW Info does report that it has thermal throttled. No, sorry, hasn't. Although it should have, I think. It's reached almost 98 degrees Celsius. It's pulled 65 watts here from the APU. But according to this, thermal throttling, no, has not taken place. So that's not too bad. Although those temperatures, yes, they're getting a bit high. But that's the same as the Intel 13th gen. It will hit higher temperatures as well. They are powerful chips with a lot of cores and relatively small. So what about the fan noise? In general, very good. What I'll do is I'll run Cinebench again and I'll stress it out to the max. And you'll hear the fans under full load now from this sample. And just to point out a few other things here, that our RAM speeds, they are running correctly. It is running in dual channel, no issues there. The timing is CL40. And if you're thinking about running a 4K 120 hertz display with this, you can. So I've tested out the HDMI port, seems to run that as well. And the one I'm using at the moment and have used is the Thunderbolt port. While the USB 4 port, you're able to get 4K 120 hertz, no issues with that. And transfers at the 40 gigabits per second to my external storage have been very good, really fast. And something a bit more demanding, which is 4K video editing here with Adobe Premiere Pro. I have a timeline that's got one of my reviews, an older review in here. Very basic edit, so there's nothing flash, no flashy animations, transitions, anything like that. And the timeline is quick enough. So playback here, this is only a quarter resolution. It's fine. It doesn't seem to be dropping any frames. You can even take it up to half there with 4K files. Now, these are some 4K files that I shot with the Sony A6400, and they are 100 megabits per second, and it's handling it just fine, the timeline there. With this spec and the kind of RAM we've got and those RAM speeds, I did really expect this. So the export time, how long will it take for 1 minute of footage here? Let's find out. As always, this is the YouTube 4K preset that I will use for the export. That's what I've been testing since day one, pretty much. So I shall hit start here on the timer and export. Now, I do expect this to be very quick, especially with that 680M graphics. And this is looking promising, very promising indeed, that it's going to finish up just over the 30-second mark, perhaps even under. Okay, so it is about to finish up. As soon as it disappears, which is about now, okay, So there's about a delay with my hitting start on the timer there. So you can say approximately 30 seconds. That's really good. That's excellent for 1 minute of 4K footage here, exporting that with Adobe Premiere Pro. A little bit of gaming now. So this is The Witcher 3. I've set it to 1080p. Yes, even 1080p. This is the latest expansion pack that added the HD textures, next generation, you could say, upgrade. And with the lowest possible settings as the preset, I'm getting 60 frames per second, so this is really impressive performance. Now you can see when you look at the GPU, it's not at its highest clocks, so it can clock up to 2.4 gigahertz, but it's only really getting up to about 2.1 I've seen maximum, and the wattage, we're looking at 32 watts at the moment. This is very playable. Now do bear in mind that the city that I'm in here is not very large, and there's not that much to render, but still enough. I think that this performance is looking pretty good there. So I'll test out one more game, which is GTA 5 that I always test with these mini PCs. We'll see how that runs with the 680M. Now this is looking a bit better. The clock rate I've seen get up to 2.2, there you go, almost 2.3. So we're getting there near the maximum turbo of the 680M. It's still not quite up there. Now it's some sort of throttling. I think it's to do with power limits. That is probably the issue here, but look at this performance. So I've got it again at 1080p. And all the normal settings for pedestrian density and viewing distance. And this performance here, this is excellent. This is really good for integrated graphics, way better than even what Intel's best Iris Xe would be. Well, similar kind of frame rate here. It just, this seems just to be slightly smoother, a little bit better. Let's get out of the car here. And we're up to around about almost 90 peak. And an average of in the 70s here for our frame rate. So super playable, 1080p. You could even raise some of those settings a little bit if you don't mind gaming about 60 frames per second. So great performance from that 680M. Linux support. So Manjaro, I did test out a live image from a USB boot drive. And I got through the initial first menus. But then to get the display to work the display out, because there are so many options in here, I did run into driver difficulty. So it doesn't seem to be, at least what I could tell, that simple to boot and use Linux with this, unless maybe you try a different distro and you're pretty savvy with Linux that you can fix driver issues there when it comes to the displays with it. So you can also, with this model here, run actually full displays with Windows, so 4K 60. Plenty of options here with the ports. I do love the fact that we've got USB 4, we've got Thunderbolt 4, we have those HDMI ports, DisplayPort, Type A ports. It really has pretty much everything for such a small size. And the fact that you can fit a 2.5 inch drive into this is pretty fantastic. Now the build quality is good, the size is great. You can use the VESA mounting bracket to put it behind a monitor if you wanted to do that, to get it out of the way, free up a little bit more desk space. And really, the graphics performance too, very good. The only thing was, I noticed that it, and I've seen it with other mini PCs, I noticed that it wouldn't get up to the full turbos of 2.4 gigahertz out of the 6800M. So why that is probably down to power limits, although I did see it reaching 65 watts from this APU. And the performance too, fantastic for such a small compact size. The only real downside was the thermals, it can get a little hot, as I showed you, up to about 98 degrees Celsius. Didn't actually trigger thermal throttling, but it can't have been too far from that. The fan, when you push it under heavy loads, yes, it gets a little audible, you will definitely hear it there, but under normal kind of use, it's not very loud, it's just really when stressed. So all up, this is a fantastic mini PC here from Geekom. This is also powered by Asus. So the AS6 does come recommended from me, gets a thumbs up if you're after a bit of a powerhouse and something that can play some older titles, games as I showed you at 1080p with very good frame rates, considering its integrated graphics is very decent. So thanks so much for watching this review. Hope to see you back in the next one. Bye for now.